morning, Michael Chase.
We've had two wonderful speakers this morning. I'm a member of the, as I said, the Luxor Endorse, Toastmaster, and so I have come to appreciate a good speech. And this morning we've had two wonderful speeches. This is an abbreviated version of a half day workshop. As you can see on the second page of what I have here now, that I'm not going to be covering a lot of the items in the workshop. I've highlighted the items that I will touch on. I'm going to move through it pretty quickly. Okay. What does it mean to make your competitors irrelevant? It means that your product is so preferred by your customers that they have no reason to consider any other provider of those products or services. Now, how do you create a product that's so preferred by your customers and potential customers that they'll have no reason to look to another vendor? You have to do two things. The first thing you have to do is understand the purpose of your business. Now, I'm going to contrast two purposes of the business and ask you which you think would be more helpful to the long-term prosperity of the business. On the one hand, Company A sees its purpose as to sell things. We're going to contrast this with Company B, which sees its purpose as to create a customer. Now, I'm going to contrast these under the circumstances that the new vendor enters the market and is selling the same products or services that Company A and B are selling. So they're facing new competition. Company A sees its purpose as to sell things. So how is it going to react to the competition? Well, it will probably increase its marketing and promotion budget. It will put more pressure on its salespeople to sell more. It may hire new salespeople. It could very likely sell to customers if it's a commercial business, to customers whose credit isn't as strong, that they have not been willing to sell to before. They are now willing to take a chance and sell to. They may well increase or improve the terms of sale, so that instead of having invoices due in 10 days, that invoice is due in 30 days, and they offer a discount for payment in 10 days. So they can improve the terms of sale, and very likely they'll start competing more on price. So they'll be lowering their prices. That's Company A. Company B sees its purpose as to create a customer. So what does it do when it faces new competition? Well, how do you create a customer? You create a customer by adding value to the products and services that you sell. And you add value to the products and services by doing one or more of four things. Customers buy products to do something that they want to do. And you create value for them by making the product either more effective, more reliable, or convenient, or more affordable to your customers. So company A starts working on how do they make their product more valuable? How can they add value to the products rather than pushing sales? So looking at these two contrasting purposes of the business, which do you think would work better for the long-term health of the company? Company A sees its purpose as to sell things. Show of hands. Anybody? All right, we got one. What company B? Two.
No, company B.
Okay. Company B, which sees its purpose as to create a customer. It does that by creating new value for its customers. Anybody? A little overwhelming. People seem to agree that the purpose of the business is to create a customer, with one exception. No. Okay, the second thing that you need to do, now, understanding the purpose of your business is the first thing you need to do to start making your competitors irrelevant. The second thing you need to do is understand your business model. A business model is a conceptual model of all of the things that your business does. And Mark Johnson provides a four-box business model framework to help you create a model of your business. These are the things that you have to pay a lot of attention to. There are a lot of details in any business, many of which you don't need to pay a lot of attention to, but these four things you have to pay a lot of attention to. Customer value proposition. That's what I was just talking about. How do you create value for your customers? Your profit formula. Creating value for your customers is great, but can you capture some of the value that you create in the form of profits for your company? Because these are not the same things. A good example of this is Whole Foods. Whole Foods sells at premium price. Well, this, if you've shopped at Whole Foods, you know that their stuff is more expensive. But Whole Foods has not been able to capture those higher prices in the form of greater profits. Their profits are ordinary, now their prices are premium. So the customer value proposition and profit formula are two different things. The third box is key resources. When you look at a company, you think of the resources typically as people and money. Those are the two resources that every company has to deal with. But there are other resources that can be critical to your business. If you're a retail business, your locations are a critical resource. If you're in a distribution business, warehouses and trucks and ways of moving things around are a critical resource. And the last box, key processes. And this is kind of the secret sauce of businesses. What are the processes involved in creating and delivering your product to customers. We've all had the experience of a company that has a good, maybe a great product, but they screw up the delivery every time, or way too often. You get the wrong thing, you get the wrong size, you get the wrong color. This is a process issue. Can you take all of these, and these are the key issues for a business. Okay, creating your business model using this framework is the second thing that you need to do to be able to make your competitors your goals. Now, how do we know that this is true? We know that this is true because of the research of two guys at Deloitte, which is a business consulting, a very large business consulting firm in this country. Michael Rayner and Mintaz Ahmed did a study of 25,000 public U.S. companies over the period from 1966 to 2010. They reviewed the financial performance of 25,000 companies, asking the question, trying to understand, what is it that companies do that leads them to exceptional performance? Of these 25,000 companies, over a period of 45 years, they found 344 companies that delivered exceptional performance. 344 companies out of 25,000. This is a little over 1% of companies. And in looking at these 344 companies, is it, what do they have in common that allows them to deliver exceptional performance consistently over long periods of time? And they summed it up in three rules. Better before cheaper, revenue before cost, and there are no other rules, which is there is nothing else that companies with exceptional performance have in common. They have a strong preference for creating a better product that is adding value to products before trying to produce it more cheaply. And in fact, they found that companies cannot do both at the same time. They can either make a better product, but it's going to be more expensive because it costs more, or they can make a cheaper product and do that well. An example of the latter is Toyota. Wonderful cars at reasonably priced. Example of the former, every luxury automaker that you can think of, BMW, Jaguar, Cadillac, they don't try and make it cheaper because they know they can't compete with it. Another example, Apple. iPhone. Starting price for the iPhone 7 is $679. That's for the 32GB version. They don't try and make a cheaper phone. They don't try to compete on price. They have made it better. And this is what you need to do. Now, before I open the floor to questions, I'm going to answer what may be your first question, which is this easy? Anybody think this is easy? No. Rayner and Bob's research. 344 companies out of 25. 500,000 over 45 years were able to achieve exceptional results. Achieving exceptional results is not easy, but it is the way to strong performance. If you want your company to live well and prosper, follow their rules. Better before cheaper, revenue before cost, and there are no other rules. That's how we make your competitors their own. Does anybody have any questions? Yes, please.
I'm just a little, I'm not totally understanding the concept of revenue before cost.
Okay, and I understand that because I really didn't get into the second rule because we are a little pressed for time. What it means is, the short version is, what it means is if you can make as much money or increase the bottom line at your company by selling more or by reducing the cost of the products that you sell, that is making them more efficiently, have a strong preference for increasing revenue. Again, as with companies looking at making better products or making their products cheaper, companies cannot do both. So have a strong preference for increasing revenue rather than becoming more efficient at producing your product or service. That's what revenue before cost is about.
So in the example you gave of the luxury vehicles, if we make the product better, then we expect to be able to charge more to increase the revenue?
And the revenue and the performance of the company, that is the income of the company. If you make it better, does it naturally mean that you can charge more? Not necessarily. For example, Amazon.com. I go to Amazon all of the time because their prices are better, they're cheaper, but Amazon's performed well. Amazon's performance has been lagging for many, many years because Jeff Bezos has been investing in new ideas. But potentially, Amazon can make a great deal of money, even though they charge less for the products they want. Is that helpful?
A little bit. So that's volume they're looking at, right?
That is volume. It's one of the components of financial performance, which is turning over your inventory more times. For example, a retail store like Sears, Macy's plans on turning over their inventory, I believe, four times a year. If you get into the discount retailers, they turn them over a lot more. Costco turns their inventory over 12 times a year. Amazon turns its inventory over 75 times a year. They hold no inventory. Their profit margins are exceptionally thin. Their profit margins are 5% or less. But because they turn over their inventory so much, they're selling, they're taking that small profit and increasing it many, many times. Costco does the same thing. They turn their inventory over like 12 times a year. Their profit, gross profit margin is, I've read, 14% on average, but they make up for the small margin with larger volume, turning over their inventory more times. Is that helpful?
Yes.
Thank you. Any other questions?
One right there.
Oh, I'm sorry. Wait.
I just wanted to know how you apply this to your business.
Well, let me give you an example. Here is Piazzaro's, by the way, the pronunciation is Piazzaro, it's Italian, not pizza. The guy who made my website, the first guy who made my website, wrote pizza, Rosa. I caught that before it went live. This is the way, this is the our customer value proposition. This is what Piazzaro sees as how we deliver value to customers. I don't know, is that helpful to you?
Well, I'm just curious what this or what your practical application to put that into practice. I mean, that's your philosophy, but kind of maybe you really can't answer it. So
most of my work for clients is setting up and fixing financial systems that are either brand new or have a lot of rot. So that we don't get to the point of improving the business beyond being able to look at financial performance realistically instead of the financial measures that many small businesses have is how much money do I have to pay? I make payroll and pay my vendors on invoices. And beyond that, there isn't a look at inventory turnover, return on assets, gross profit margin, things like that. So, for the most part, for my clients, I don't do a lot of work in improving performance. At Piazza Rosa, I do a lot of work in improving performance. And this is just an example of it. Be happy to walk you through my processes. Anyone else? I return the lecture.